Thank you, sir. We were hearing seeing a good surgery at good unifocal lens implantation, and just coming to offering a multifocal lens implantation, like we all have been good surgeons, good unifocal lens implantation procedures, but we never felt the need of the patient. So like, when it comes to multifocal implantation, it is just understanding the need of the patient, elderly patients, what exactly the visual needs of their day-to-day requirements and the lifestyle, based on which the whole multifocal lens concept is developed now. Have we reached the summit of it? Not yet. We still have a lot of issues to be discussed upon. Like we are seeing an eye that is getting, the spherical aberration keeps changing with age. So we need to address to so many issues when you come to multifocal lenses. What distance we really want to correct the patient to? Distance, near, intermediate, all together, or is it only a distant intermediate vision, which is the patient's real requirement? And we do have a lot of issues regarding the type of lens, technology, what we are using up. And as a early multifocal lens user, I've been used to technology of refractive lenses, wherein the whole two major difficulty will be is on addressing on contrast sensitivity and your photic phenomenon. And we all know that due to the dual focusing system, the light distribution results in contrast being reduced. And the various zones resulted in a lot of glare and halos. So we were giving the patient a more of distant and intermediate vision and more comfortable in the daytime, but not much of nighttime, lot of nighttime difficulties were inducing in the form of glare, halos and starbursts. But over a period of time, things are developing a lot. I need to spend a lot of pre-operative chat time to the patients. Really make them talk to find out what is the real lifetime needs, sir. What is the type of personality of patients you're handling? And of course, the ocular pathology is to be ruled out. And what is your vision goal? What are you aiming at? What is the, you are aiming at a more of a near dominant situation or a intermediate, what is the need? And of course, on the measurement side, we need to have a biometry. I'll certainly insist on an immersion, if not an optical, but certainly not a contact biometry. So it's more of an art than science. Like we keep talking to the patient, we develop our own skills. And as I said, we have evolved from a period of time when in 1983, when Hoffer did the first multifocal lens, he went through this concept by having a decentered lens, the dual focus, one through the aphakic and other through the phakic. Now we are talking, come to the level of neuroadaptation, talking to the patient about various newer terminologies. And then came the diffractive lenses. And then after a period of time, slowly a combination of diffractive and with the refractive, which is what I'm going to really stress more upon, which is I'm more comfortable with. And basically, it's a new lens design, which is the basic lens design we are all aware of, the Akrisoft single piece platform, hydrophobic. We are all aware of, basically being a pediatric ophthalmologist, again, myself, I prefer this Akrisoft lens in my pediatric cataracts. And this, what is this apodization technology? Rather than having a different zones, which is adding up to the photic phenomenon, we are removing the foot. The central ridge is more larger. As it blends down to the periphery, it becomes thinner. So the light distribution is a bit uniform to avoid or minimize this contrast situation and this photic phenomenon. And this is the basis on which the whole this lens works, which has got again an option of 2.5 at, where if you are handling a patient who needs more of a distance and intermediate vision lifestyle, he can go for a low at. He doesn't mind having a small near at. And if you are looking at a patient who is in more in need of more of a reading habit, then you can without any compromise on his distant vision, because as the pupil dilates, the lens becomes a bit more of distant dominant, and the pupil is small, the central point is more of a near focus, so it is a beautiful lens for both near and distance together, with added together the minimization of the contrast decrease and the photic phenomenon. That is the beauty of this particular technology, which I have been of late regularly been using. And we always know that we avoid toric, anything beyond 0.75 as a choice, we avoid. But then, if we have a regular astigmatism, there is no higher order aberration like coma, if we have an aberration profile to measure, we can always still offer the patient a toric multifocal combination, if you are still confident about. Again, in 2.5 with a more intermediate distance combination, we want to have an extended distance, intermediate and near, we can go for a plus 3, again with a toric combination also. And even I tell my patients when I operate on them, there will be a possibility of a minimal requirement for a near add in certain dim illuminated situations. So these sort of minimal preoperative counseling is very essential so that the patient is understanding what's going to happen. And again, neuroadaptation again is one thing which we need to tell them about, that they don't get it immediately. So minimal halos and those things are going to vanish off over a period of time, which we have to counsel to the patients in advance. And as a pediatric ophthalmologist, again, when we operate on high hypermetropes, we may be handling a small esotropia squint component also. If they have amblyopia or a lazy eye, already the contrast is down, so they may be in for a surprise. So all such pre-op evaluation has to be performed improperly. So we all know that the ideal patient is who really spectacle independence, and it should be an easygoing personality, accepting to the minimal things that can once in a while go wrong. Maybe a small spherical error or a small spherical error, they don't really mind about it. And again, like whatever the task they require, if that is given, like if the reading is comfortable, they don't mind a little bit of a distance compromise. An ideal initial choice of your patient's choice will be something like a moderate to high hypermetropia patient. They are the very, because they are always dependent on their spectacles. And not so ideal patients, we all know the unrealistic expectations. If they are very nighttime drivers, to be specifically speaking, not to be avoided, and avoid low myopes because they are very excellent near vision in the presbyopic age group. And one other thing we can always, our scenario of patients in the culture, what our thing is, most of them don't have a proper eye evaluation before the age of 40 till presbyopia. Surprisingly, as a pediatric ophthalmologist, we see a lot of anisometropias. Always do bilateral biometry. You may find that you'll have a lot of refractive surprises between both eyes in the astigmatism K values and even in the axial lens. Not regularly, but still once in a while. So always listen to the patient preoperatively. So what exactly, what is the real patient's need, and based on which you plan your surgery, your lens, technology, anything. And again, astigmatism I already dealt with, like irregular astigmatism to be totally avoided. If you have an abrometer, avoid third order, higher order aberrations like coma and fourth order aberrations like keratoconus. And good macular function doesn't mean that we'll have to always have higher end gadgets. Simpler OPD evaluation tests like a pinhole test for distance and super pinhole test for a plus 3 add on an initial NS2, NS3 cataract, anatomically looking at the macula, if possible doing a macular function test in the form of amsler if possible, any macular pathology like ERM, progressing diabretinopathy, ARMD should be totally be avoided. Accurate biometry, again, nothing much to be insisted upon. IOL formula of your choice, whatever you are performing. And our protocol is, you do all the basic evaluation, we do a biometry, we do a topography, we do a specular. Again, when you have a endothelial dystrophy or a corneal epithelial dystrophy, please do avoid them. Severe dry eye, avoid those cases. OCT macula, if you pick up some subtle retinal pathology, avoid them. And counseling, again, this is a major part. We do need to spend a lot of time. And then maybe once a patient chooses a multifocal, what we do in our center is we repeat the biometry on another day to get to an unviolated tear film. That is more important. So we need to have a spot on biometry. And the basic minimum requirements to start a basic multifocal implantation in your practice, I'll say one designated calibrated keratometer, which you handle by yourself, not anyone else, and at least an immersion biometry and a good macular function test. I think that can really kickstart a basic sort of, and a lot of scenarios I just thought of, I'll skip. And when it comes to surgical situations, we may land up with an intraoperative issues like a capsular tear, again debatable whether we can implant it or not. And again, on the mature cataract slide I remember it's one of my classmates who came with the other eye multifocal, and we may have to be prepared. The next technology, I think we are going to see how we can handle these sort of complicated scenarios. Intraoperative issues, always be more clear on your prompt, on your rexus, focus on your rexus, use new instruments. Many of us may have reusable instruments in your astigmatism induced by the wound, your rexus, overlap, everything is essential. Good PC polishing and visco wash from under the IOL. A good centration of the lens in the back itself is a very effective thing. So as rightly said, it's always to under deliver and over, under promise and over deliver in a multifocal lens. Thank you.